We have already seen conditional probabilities, which sort of are used to express how much one probability or one event influences another event. Now there is sort of the opposite notion, which is called independence. We want to say, when are two events independent? For example, if I throw a die and I consider the weather, then probably it's like the weather typically doesn't influence the result of the die. So I would say these two events are like whether it's sunny is independent of the fact whether my die is a two. And this is what we want to define now. So again, we're on a we consider a probability space. As always, this is the space omega AP. And we now consider two events. Two events, A and B, both of the sigma algebra, are called independent if we have the following property. If we look at so we want to look at the probability that A and B occur. Recall the intersection as the end sign. So we look at the probability that A and B occur at the same time. And then this is supposed to be the same that the probability of A occurs times the probability that B occurs. And if you consider what we have already seen very often when we, for example, model throwing two dice, then the way I always did it is like the first die has probabilities like 1 over 6 for each event. The second die has probability 1 over 6 to each event. Typically, you assume that the first die doesn't influence the second die. So the probability of that the first, the first die has a 5 and the second die has a 3 is simply the product of these two probabilities, which in the case of uniform distributions is then 1 over 36. And this is because we believe that these dice are independent of each other. Another way to see this is observation. If we have if A is independent of B, if and only if, so if we compute the probability of A given B, then this is the same as the probability of A directly. So the probability that I get a 2 on my die, conditioned on whether on the fact that it's sunny outside, doesn't depend on this fact whether it's sunny. It's just the probability that I have a 2 on my die. And this is what we call independent. Now, so far we have defined whether two events are independent. And in the long run, we want to define what does it mean for two random variables to be independent. But for this, we need one more intermediate step. We need to say, when is a family of events independent? So we say, in black, a family of events, ai, I in some index at I, is called independent. And now that's always the interesting question. What comes if you have either finitely or infinitely many? How do you do that? Do you simply carry over the definition we had before to what we have now? It's a bit more complex. So a family is called independent if for all finite subsets J in the index set. So we have this big index set. It could contain infinitely many indices. So for example, all natural numbers. So then we would have countably many events. And now we say we just look at a countable number, at a finite number J. So J is a finite subset of this index set. If for all finite subsets J we have, and now we want to have the property that we have seen above. Now we look at the intersection of all I in J AI. So this is a finite intersection of sets. And the probability that that happens is supposed to be exactly the same as the product of the probabilities of the individual sets. Okay, this is sort of the naive generalization of the statement we had above, like the last line at least. And this is what when we call a family independent. A family of events is called independent. I want to simply make one note of caution here. There's also a notion that is called pairwise independent, and this is not the same. So pairwise independent would mean you have you only consider pairs of random variables, or maybe I just write it down as a side remark. Family is called pairwise independent. If for all I and j that you could have in your index set or that you could pick, you have this property that we have just for two events. So the p of ai intersected aj is the same as p of ai times p of aj. This does not, at least in general, imply independence in the above notion. So observe, in the above notion we have arbitrary finite, like we have finite intersections, but more than, it could be more than two, and this is important. It makes a difference whether I'm allowed to look only at two intersections, an intersection of two sets or more of them. Okay, so I think this pairwise independent notion is not really important for us right now. It is just to make you aware that this is, that there are two different things here. I now also want to introduce what does it mean that two random variables are independent. Now observe, for two random variables, maybe I write it down first and then I explain what's going on. Two random variables, and they are now called X and Y, they live on the same probability space, that's important. The images do not necessarily need to be in the same, so maybe I write it differently. So X goes from omega to some other space omega 1, and Y goes from omega to some other space omega 2. So it's important that they start and that they are defined on the same space, but the target space can be different. Two random variables are called independent. And then the definition is now, if the sigma algebras that are induced by these random variables on the original space are independent families. I first write it down and then I explain it a bit more. Two random variables are called independent if their induced sigma algebras, sigma x, sigma y, are independent. So for all A in sigma of X and B in sigma of Y, we have that the probability of A and B is the same as the probability of A times the probability of B. And this is what it means that two random variables are independent. Random variables are independent. Now I want to introduce finally a notation that is often used in, well, in some areas of probability at least, and in some areas of machine learning as well, the notation. So we write A independent B, so this independent sign, this didn't work very well, let me just make it a bit more clearly. So it's like a pi sign just turned on upside down, or if you want, like an orthogonality sign, but with two of these bars instead of one, means independence. And we also write sometimes, if we have random variables, we also write the random variable x is independent of the random variable y. Notation for independence. Okay. So independence is really one of the key properties of probability theory. So whenever things are independent, they turn out really nicely. So for example, we are going to see the central limit theorem later on that says, if you have lots of independent random variables and you take their sum, they're going to behave nicely. in machine learning, we have sort of a similar scenario. In like many areas in statistical learning theory are based on independence, where you say, assume we sample data points from some space independently, then we can sort of, for example, make a generalization bound that tells us that the likelihood is high that our machine learning algorithm is going to produce the correct results. And this, at least in this branch, the easiest assumption is always what happens if your samples are independent, because then sort of like the intuition is independent samples, if you sample it often enough, then you sort of see what is going on. Whereas independent samples, that is not so much the case.